Voy a hablar en español. I'm going to talk in Spanish. It's better so you don't suffer my accent. Voy a tratar de dar un breve panorama para que tengan una idea de lo que significa la, pues, una especie de muerte de la libertad de expresión reciente en México, de lo que significa en el contexto mundial, porque no es el único país en donde la libertad de expresión está siendo gravemente atacada. Apenas llegada a esta ciudad de Nueva York, el 25 de abril pasado, recibí la noticia de un periodista guerrerense, Francisco Pacheco, había sido asesinado en el pueblo de Taxco. Dos días después, se supo de otro asesinato, el del locutor de radio Apolonio Hernández de Mitla, Oaxaca. Fueron dos asesinatos en menos de tres días. Nuevamente está poniéndose muy caliente, como suele decirse en México, el asunto. Esta death of journalism, la muerte del periodismo, estamos ante la muerte del periodismo, desde luego que esta es una pregunta retórica, pero el periodismo, o sea, sabemos que el periodismo no va a morir, pero sí, también estamos muy conscientes de que está atravesando un momento crítico y no solo en México. La mayoría ha escuchado hablar sobre los constantes asesinatos de periodistas en mi país, México. Es difícil señalar a los responsables. No hay una solución sencilla a la mano. Los asesinos están entre los traficantes de droga, hace unos años sobre todo, están entre las autoridades corrompidas, pero también están entre esa comunidad mexicana que últimamente vive dentro de un caos en donde, como se ha dicho mil veces, reina la impunidad. En la última edición de Freedom of the Press 2015, como pueden ver ustedes aquí, en la última edición de su reporte anual, publicado por Freedom House desde 1980, se informa que la libertad de prensa a nivel mundial declinó en 2014 a su punto más bajo en los últimos 10 años. Es muchísimo, es una locura. Este estudio sobre la libertad de prensa de Freedom House fue realizado en 199 países y México, yo no quiero venir a hablar mal aquí de mi país, pero sí quiero denunciar, quedó en el lugar 139 de baja incidencia de libertad de expresión. De los países evaluados durante 2014, 63, es decir, 32%, se consideró libre, 63 se consideraron libres para la prensa, en donde hay cierto ejercicio de libertad de prensa, 71 países se consideraron parcialmente libres y otros 65, en otros 65 países se pudo comprobar que no, casi no existe la libertad de expresión. La cantidad de periodistas asesinados en América Latina y el Caribe ha aumentado un 60% en la última década. Acá pueden ver ustedes otra de las gráficas. Nuestras fuentes fueron básicamente artículo 19 y Freedom House. En PEN México trabajamos mucho con artículo 19 porque confiamos mucho en su seriedad, en sus estadísticas, en el rigor a la hora de comprobar datos. Entonces, son nuestras dos fuentes principales. En esta gráfica se puede ver, titulada El Estado Mundial, es de artículo 19, está en términos de porcentajes lo que les acabo de decir, el 45% de países, de 199 países, etcétera. Es lo que les acabo de comentar. Las víctimas de agresiones en México en 2015 fueron 84 mujeres, las pongo en primer lugar, porque está creciendo mucho el ataque de género, el ataque contra mujeres. Está creciendo de muchas maneras, no solamente está creciendo como agresiones, está creciendo como acoso, como bullying a través de las redes sociales, vía las redes sociales. Fueron atacados, agredidos 84 mujeres, 244 hombres, en total 328. 69 medios periodísticos de comunicación, podían ser televisoras, podían ser periódicos como Río 12 en Sinaloa, que hace una formidable labor. 69 fueron atacados también. Es decir, que yéndonos a un microcosmos, después de ver lo que ocurre en todo el mundo, el número de periodistas asesinados en Latinoamérica y el Caribe ha aumentado 60% en la última década. Y repito, México es el país que se encuentra en primer lugar. Desafortunadamente, México es el país donde más periodistas murieron asesinados. En 2015, 14 periodistas asesinados, además de 2 periodistas desaparecidos. Le siguen Honduras con 10 homicidios, Brasil con 8 y Colombia con 5 y Guatemala con 3 homicidios. En México, entre 2000 y 2015, fueron asesinados 82 periodistas. Bueno, no puedo comentar, no tengo palabras para comentar lo que significa esa pérdida de 82 personas dedicadas a hacer bien su trabajo, a informar a la sociedad, a denunciar lo que no debe ser, porque el periodismo es anomalía. El periodismo no se trata de contar buenas noticias y ser felices y sonreír y la happy face, no. El periodismo se trata de denunciar lo que es anómalo, lo que no es justo, lo que no se debe, lo que está mal. Entonces, es terrible perder a 82 personas. Es verdaderamente terrible. Aquí tenemos los rostros de algunos periodistas, 4 mexicanos y 4 periodistas de otros países, 4 periodistas que son de Honduras, de Guatemala, de Brasil, asesinados. Ustedes pueden ver sus rostros, no son los rostros de criminales, no son los rostros de narcotraficantes. Por supuesto que hay historias de periodistas que se corrompen. En mi último libro dediqué un capítulo a un periodista que se corrompió y que acabó destrozando a su familia. Por supuesto que eso existe, pero esta gente no estaba en ese nivel ni en esa situación. Este es el mapa de nuestro país, México. La idea de este encuentro de PEN México, PEN American, PEN Internacional, tiene que ver con analizar las respectivas agendas de los países, analizar qué sucede y de qué manera podemos ayudar. Nunca hay un solo culpable, es como en cualquier matrimonio. En cualquier matrimonio la responsabilidad es 50-50, 50%, 50%. Aquí hay una especie de matrimonio perverso entre Estados Unidos y México, en donde estamos, realmente somos responsables todos de lo que ocurre. Estas cifras de 82 periodistas asesinados a lo largo de 15 años, se calcula que se presume que la mayoría tenía que ver, de esos asesinatos tenía que ver con el trabajo. Este hombre es el que fue asesinado el 25 de abril. Nos decía hace rato Lidia Cacho o Marcela Turati, perdón, han sido muchas cosas el día de hoy, muchas emociones. Este hombre no se dedicaba a denunciar el narcotráfico, porque está cambiando todo en este momento. Este hombre, cuyo rostro ven un poquito con el background de su ciudad Taxco, una ciudad que está considerada como patrimonio universal de la humanidad en Guerrero, el mayor productor de amapola, heroína, cocaína, etcétera, en la sierra de Guerrero. Este hombre se dedicaba a denunciar las malas conductas, por decirlo de manera sencilla y casi infantil. Se dedicaba a denunciar a los gobiernos corruptos, a los gobiernos que no le cumplen a los ciudadanos. Quise hacer un pequeño homenaje porque en este 2016 no solo ha muerto Francisco Pacheco el 25 de abril, murió Apolonio Hernández el 27 de abril, dos días después de llegar aquí a Nueva York, llegó otra noticia a mi teléfono celular, fue asesinado en Jutla, Oaxaca, otra zona del país, del inmenso país lleno de riquezas que es México, no solo de riquezas barrocas en la arquitectura como Taxco, que es la ciudad de La Plata, sino riquezas, minería, las personas, en fin. Matan a Apolonio Hernández, locutor de radio, a él le decían el pajarito. El 21 de enero mataron a Marcos Hernández Bautista, a René Reynel Martínez lo mataron el 22 de enero, a Anabel Flores Salazar, en donde se incorporó todo un tema de género, publicaron sus fotos asesinada, fue una cosa espantosa en muchos periódicos y revistas mexicanas. Y también asesinaron a Moisés Dactú, dueño de un medio, el 20 de febrero. Es decir, apenas estamos en abril y ya hay 6 periodistas asesinados. Hace casi un año, el 31 de julio de 2015, sonó muchísimo por toda la ciudad. Yo soy una persona que viaja mucho o en taxi o en transporte público como Metrobús, como Subway, como todo eso. Y oí por todos los lugares de la Ciudad de México hablar de Rubén Espinosa, que es el que está en el centro, de Mile Virginia Martínez, de Alejandra, olvido ahorita estos…
Nadia.
Nadia, por favor, Nadia Vera, Yesenia, la activista, y Yesenia, una chica que estudiaba cosmética y estética. Para trabajar en salones de belleza futuro, ¿no? Este es el edificio en donde ellos vivían. Fui a la ofrenda que se le hizo, al funeral que se le hizo al día siguiente. Los vecinos estaban completamente choqueados, dolidos, era gente muy joven, era gente buena, gente que hacía bien las cosas y todos valían, todas sus vidas valían lo mismo. Bueno, hasta el momento, se va a cumplir ya un año, en julio próximo, el 31 de julio, no hay ninguna noticia. Los familiares de algunos de ellos, de Rubén Espinosa, sobre todo, que es el fotoperiodista, se la han pasado pidiendo amparos para que sean consideradas las pruebas que ellos proporcionaron. Y sin embargo, no hay nada. Es como dijo Jennifer Clement, la presidenta internacional de PEN, desde octubre pasado, dijo: México es un país en donde hay muchos asesinados, pero no hay asesinos. ¿Dónde están los asesinos? En las cárceles no están los asesinos de periodistas. Todo parece normal, ¿no? Este es un homenaje que le hicieron sus amigos fotoperiodistas a Rubén. Es un homenaje que le hicieron precisamente a lo largo de ese trágico mes de agosto, después del 31 de julio. Yo estaba dando una clase de crónica, mi especialidad es la crónica dentro del periodismo, y varios alumnos muy jóvenes, entre 20 y 25 años, escribieron reseñas y escribieron crónicas sobre Rubén Espinosa y sobre ese asesinato que en el DF nos cimbró, porque en el DF, que ya no es DF, ahora es la Ciudad de México, cambió de nombre nuestra amada ciudad. Ese asesinato nos cimbró, ese asesinato nos hizo darnos cuenta que no es cierto que vivimos en una burbuja de seguridad. Se burlaron mucho de mí, alumnos míos en los Mochis hace 6 años, no se burlaron, pero me reclamaron porque les dije que vivíamos en una burbuja de seguridad y que era una ironía que la Ciudad de México, que tradicionalmente había sido la más insegura del país porque era la capital, etcétera, etcétera, era una ironía que esa ciudad ahora fuera la más segura del país. Ya había comenzado, ya había declarado la guerra contra el narcotráfico Felipe Calderón, el expresidente, ya todavía estábamos en la época de Calderón cuando yo comenté eso y me reclamaron los alumnos mochitecos de Sinaloa. Aquí, este es un libro que escribí, se llama Vida cotidiana y narcotráfico, cuando llegaron los bárbaros. Gracias a este libro viajé a 16 ciudades. Lo importante no es haber viajado a 16 ciudades, vaya, siempre me gustó lo que llamamos en México pueblear, que es viajar en coche, ir recorriendo todos los pueblos, sino que lo que a mí me importaba en este caso era que pude hablar con mucha gente de México. con mucha gente mexicana que me dijo, al país se lo está llevando la chingada, el país está yendo al diablo, el país estamos llenos de inseguridad. En San Luis Potosí yo no me sentí nada bien, entre otras cosas, hubo 72, ok, el tiempo se está acabando, hubo 72 personas o 75 de público, pero esas personas nos dijeron, estamos viviendo en la violencia, y esto viene de hace 6, 8 años. Otra cosa, este libro, a mí no me pasó nada grave, o sea, a mí nadie me ha amenazado de muerte, mi tema es la vida cotidiana, a mí no me pasa nada grave, jamás voy a capitalizar ese tema, pero sí retiraron la edición en Veracruz, en Jalapa, en San Luis Potosí, en tres entidades muy importantes en cuanto apareció. Estuvo un mes por ahí y la retiraron. Eso habla de un estado del país. Ya estaba Enrique Peña Nieto como presidente. Esta es una portada de un reportaje que hice en 1992. Está Elliot Weinberger, que muchos de ustedes lo deben conocer, escritor neoyorquino. Y él, bueno, él me dio una entrevista sobre las drogas, que en este momento no les voy a citar. Pero quiero decirles que es un tema que nos ha preocupado siempre y que los editores siempre nos han pedido, haz esto, por favor. Esto era Intelectuales y Drogas, hablaban de la percepción extrasensorial bajo el efecto de ciertas sustancias. Pero a los editores siempre les ha preocupado, porque hace 100 años que no estamos con ese problema. Por último, no se mata, la verdad, matando periodistas. Esta es una de las mantas más importantes de todas las miles de marchas que hemos hecho en México y que hasta ahora no vemos que hayan servido de nada. Quería decirles eso antes de que mis compañeros que tienen mucho conocimiento y experiencia hablen de este tema. Mil gracias.
Pedro, I wanted to turn to you first, maybe, and ask just for a bit of historical perspective. Mexico is now, you know, one of the most dangerous countries in the world for journalists. We'd like to get into this later in the panel. There, apart from the murders, there are a lot of other restrictions on free expression and on the media as well, which are maybe less obvious but no less important. But I'd like to turn to you first to just get maybe a bit of historical perspective or context into, you know, how Mexico has come to be at this point, right? Now, in terms of the sort of crisis for free expression and the media in Mexico.
Yes, as you know, Mexico started the first social revolution in the 20th century, but then immediately that social revolution that started in 1910, and some historians tell us that it really ended on 1921 with Álvaro Obregón. From the beginning, that social revolution was diverted from its origins, social justice, free expression, and democracy. The first and most important agenda of that revolution was a phrase from Francisco Madero's that was very clear. It said, sufragio efectivo, no reelección. Each vote counts, and there will not be any re-election. And then we had 72 years of the PRI, the same party ruling the country, with something that one of our best poets, José Emilio Pacheco, called the metrical sexenal system, the sistema metrico sexenal. And each 6 years, everything changed to remain the same. And that apparatus controlled everything in Mexico, from press to market, to education, to health system, and wherever you think. And it created what we call in Mexico clientelas, groups of unions, governors, small organizations in the different states. And for those 72 years, it controlled the entire country, controlling all these small groups. And there was a movement that obviously started with 1968 and the massacre of the students in the second day of October, a very slow movement towards democratization, towards free expression, and towards a more equal country. It took us from 1968 to 2000 to gain democracy. So it really was a very slow movement. And it involved civil society, of course, and it involved the press. We will never have arrived to the 2000 democracy in Mexico with the change of the PRI and the beginning of a apparently new era with Vicente Fox without the press and without civil society. They were entangled in a really free movement to change the country. And then almost immediately, this democracy that Carlos Fuentes labeled the democracia adolescente, the teen democracy, and I started from the beginning saying, we don't have a teen democracy. We will never arrive to the teenage years. So this very weak democracy was converted into a partycracy. To partidocracia. The Paris immediately kidnapped that movement from the civil society and from the press, and every organ that remained important or free in Mexico was co-opted, was kidnapped by the Paris. So now you have, for example, an electoral institute in Mexico that it's run by the Paris. You have even what it's called the IFAI, the Institute for Access to Information, that it's ruled by the Paris. And it was not the same when it began. We were really proud as Mexicans of our electoral institute. We're really proud about the first commissioners of the IFAI because they were citizens. They came to these organizations from non-governmental organizations. They came from activists. They were citizens trying to change the country. But it really was kidnapped almost from the beginning. So now we have an electoral institute that it's very weak, that we don't believe in it, that it's very probable that the first election of Andrés Manuel López Obrador against Felipe Calderón was already turned by a fake, and as you remember, there was less than 1 point the difference. But then they destroyed the evidence, and that's the thing that I want to tell of these last years. We keep destroying evidence. So in this panel we have really, and the word is not small in this case, heroic journalists that have risked their life to try to give us some evidence of the horrible corruption, the impunity, and the tendency in Mexico of covering up every possible investigation. There is a very well-known crime writer in Mexico, Paco Ignacio Taibo II. And Paco Ignacio, long ago, 20 years ago, said that we cannot do a police mystery in Mexico, a police procedural in Mexico, because that will be it's absolutely counterintuitive. In Mexico, the police never resolves a crime. So we cannot write a police procedural because that novel will be the novel of how the police covers the crime and how the real criminals get away with the crime. And they live among us, they threaten us, and they are just normal citizens walking in the streets, and they will have been prosecuted in almost any other country. But the thing is, that I don't know if you have read probably the person in the world that I don't think even with Prozac he will be available to live his daily life, it's Julian Assange. No, he's the person in the world that has read more horrible information about politicians and about all the leaks that he has been able to read. I don't know how he's alive, but he said very clearly that it's not only Mexico, it's the world, that civil society is dead. That his old take on this thing. We don't have a civil society nowadays. We just have electronic exchange of capital. And that's our own reality all over the world. That's the consequence of neoliberalism. And we in Mexico, and that's, I'm gonna end with that, we didn't even have neoliberalism. We always think that Carlos Salinas de Gortari sold all Mexico to free market and free enterprise and neoliberalism. But in Mexico, we have our own experience and our own take on neoliberalism. I mean, it could be called cuateliberalism because everything went for a friend. There was no free market. All those things that were privatized to a person or a group that were part of that clientele, those groups that the PRI controlled at the time. So I don't want to be very grim on the picture, but we are really living in a very special moment in the world, and in Mexico we are living without, I don't think at this moment, any options of democracy or of free expression.
Thank you very much, Pedro. We've heard about the problems and the sort of the statistics and the situation in Mexico with regards to murders of journalists in a sort of broad brush approach. I wanted to turn a little bit to sort of the more personal or what some of the impact would be from these murders. I was recently in Mexico City at a conference, and I sat down in the second row of the conference, and I noticed in front of me there were a lot of women and children. And it was only after they started speaking that I realized that all the people sitting in the front row were the family members of journalists who had been murdered, very small children, wives, mothers, fathers. And it really hit home for me the personal impact. When when I'm sitting in New York and reading about a murder of a journalist, it's very distancing. But when I saw these small children sitting right in front of me at this Article 19 presentation last month, it really sort of hit home, the very personal and immediate impact that this has, not just on free expression more broadly or on the media or on access to information, but on the families concerned. So I wanted to turn to two of the people who are working on the front lines sort of with these journalists and who have faced very personal threats themselves to talk a little bit more about apart from the big picture and the theoretical aspects about what this means on a very personal level and how you deal with people who have lost their loved ones, who are struggling to survive after the murder of, in some cases it's the family breadwinner anyway. So I wanted to turn it over to talk a little bit more about some of these personal stories and aspects. Lydia first, and then
Marcela. Okay, thank you. How are you? I am not here for complaining about anything. Our responsibility as journalists and writers is documenting reality, is documenting the lives that matter, which are the lives of every human being, even the lives of the people that do good and the lives of the people that commit crimes, because we must understand the reason why they commit crimes, how they were educated, how they were raised, if during their childhood they were abused, if during their childhood there were crimes committed against them, if poverty gave them the only choice of working in the fields of the narco, for example, in some states in the north of Mexico. Our work is not to complain. Our work is to investigate, is to be aware of the moral imperative that means to become a real journalist, an investigative reporter, a writer. It means to keep on the ethical radar all the time, to keep it alive all the time. But in order to do so, we need to understand the value of humanity, of human lives. 20 years ago, I started investigating crimes against children and women in particular, because almost nobody in the newspapers I was working at were doing so. For my editors, it was ridiculous to investigate, for example, violence against children, pedophilia, for example. It was like something they thought was a crime that was only happening to certain kind of children that probably did something wrong to deserve it. And 20 years ago, everybody laughed in the newspapers at some of the very few women that were working there, investigating crimes against women, for example, or gender inequality. For 10 years, the people at the newspapers I work at laughed at me, saying that I was a crazy feminist and it didn't make any sense and I was not going to accomplish anything. So my editors are back there in the town I started being a journalist, doing nothing, probably alcoholics, and I'm here with 40 awards for journalism, so there's a lesson there. And it has to do with the fact that I do believe in what I do. It has to do with the fact that most of us, like Marcela and a lot of the journalists, and especially female journalists that are working in Mexico, we learn new ways of doing journalism. And this is something we have to account for, because we keep telling all the horrors that are happening. Of course, it's important to document that. But it is important to say that we have been creating a new form of journalism. Back then, 20 years ago, we did not know that it was human rights journalism, or peace journalism, as they call it right now in Norway, for example. But it is what we're doing. And the fact that we're doing so means that people are learning not only the horrors that are happening in our country and in other countries, in Central America or South America, even the US or Canada or any other country we travel to document human stories, but also it means that we are here to listen to people and to try to tell the story from the perspective of the survivors. We cannot keep doing this kind of journalism that centers and focuses all the time on victimhood. Mexico is a country that has been created and has been adopting a culture of Guadalupana, the Virgin of Guadalupe, of the guilty Christians, of the Catholics that blame themselves for everything. And here we are, a new generation of journalists that are saying this is not it. We are not guilty for the shit these politicians are bringing up on our lives. We are not guilty for the illegality of our justice criminal system. We are announcing it, we are denouncing it, we're analyzing it, and we're saying what's wrong with it. What is really interesting for me is that the new generation that follows mine, which is Marcela's, and she will talk about it right now, has learned how to do this kind of journalism in which we can understand and study people, but also do it from a perspective in which we are prepared to do so. What I mean is, we have studied psychology, we have studied pedagogy, we have studied every kind of specialization in which we can, for example, interview victims of drug crimes or victims of any other crime in Mexico that can explain their perspective and whatever happens to them. And from a point of view that we do understand, that we are analyzing, that we can do fact-checking, which is very important. In Mexico, for a long, long time, journalists didn't even know what it meant, fact-checking, which is really important. And I think that this is something that women brought to Mexican journalism, fact-checking. This is really important. This is one of the things that we brought here. We are saying this is, we are demonstrating every step of the way that we do have the evidence for everything we write about. And this is something that we have to celebrate. There is a new kind of journalism, a human rights journalism that is doing really serious fact-checking. Then the other thing has to do with the fact that we are being able to document not only the perspective of the victims and survivors, but also documenting what is happening to the criminals and to the government agents or to the justice system agents that are doing their best or their worst to better or to damage the situation. And we are there. I am not a negative person, nor I am a very optimistic person. I am just a woman in search of truth. And I think that's what we're doing here. We're trying to understand within that awful context that Magali talked about, but we're also to note something. When Magali started talking, I noticed the faces of most of you. You were like, shit, not again. This is gonna be terrible. And I get it. It is what is happening. Mexico is full of that. Everybody's telling the worst part of the story, and that's important. But it's so important to go deeper into it and understand the good part of the story. We are advancing tremendously. There are more NGOs in Mexico doing human rights than ever in history in Latin America, ever. 90% of all NGOs in Mexico, especially the ones for human rights, freedom of expression, and freedom of the press, are run and have been founded by women, like, for example, Marcela here. So we are doing a great deal of efforts, intelligent efforts, professional efforts to change things, and we are moving the structure. And that is why the crisis is so evident right now. They are trying to kill us. They have tried to kill us. They have tortured us, some of us. They have put us in jail, and we come out, and we keep telling the truth, and we keep fighting. And that is something that we have to value and put on the table. We cannot keep on just telling the dark side of the story, because it wouldn't mean anything. We need to understand what keeps us here. And the reasons why we are still here are just that we have been able to understand the value of human life, that of what Donald Trump, for example, has no idea of. And I think that I would just jump off and ask Marcela a couple of questions. And it is, I would like to know, Marcela, how different it is for you to be a female journalist than it was for me like 30 years ago. Do you find a difference? I mean, do you feel it's being a woman means, does it mean anything to you? Does it play a role, or it doesn't matter? Do you feel like, do you feel any kind of aggression because you're a woman within your context as a reporter?
Hi. Okay, I will speak in English. yes, I felt that the women, we have like a new role now in Mexico. I think the women journalists have been organizing to take care of the others, to take care of ourselves too. And like we are the first that we are protesting and like trying to organize some trainings to the other journalists to be safe. But for us it's really difficult. The colleagues or they think that we are like crazy and that, I don't know, that they are not, like, not so compromised to this thing. And the women journalists, we are, like, trying to do different things. In the newsroom, always, the women journalists, we have been, like, in the last level, always. The last one who you choose to go to cover one important thing. There are always the men, and there are always men, the ones who direct a newsroom. But now I think it's changing, and I can see, for example, in Ciudad Juarez. In Ciudad Juarez and El Diario de Juarez, that is a newsroom, really important, when they face all the violent period in 2010, and the journalists who cover the crime in the city was killed, the women journalists, like they start asking that they want to be the one who's sustituya, who well, replace this man. So there were like five women, always like covering this war, and one of them covered the militaries and how the militaries came to the city and how they killed people. Another one, the jail and all the police things. The other, the mayor, that is a narco, that is a drug. Famous for these links with the drug. Another doing investigation, and another one was the boss of these crazy women. And they were really, really worried of how to cover this war, and they create a network and organize to protect the whole reporters in Ciudad Juárez. And for example, that was the Red de Periodistas de Ciudad Juárez, the network journalists in Ciudad Juárez. And as this network, there were created many others in Mexico. I belong to one of them in 2006. Me and another colleagues, all women, we are always surprised that we are the women who are always like in the front line. We organize ourselves. First, it was just to cover poverty, because I am a journalist who was always covering poverty and social issues. But in 2008, that the war against drugs started, we say like, okay, we have to do something. There are many people who is killing. There are many journalists who are in danger. So we have to do something different. So we change our trainings, and we start asking people from Colombia or from the United Nations, and we didn't know what to do. Ask if somebody want to give us some classes how to cover the drug war. No? So we start like having these classes, and we start learning how to interview one children who is orphan because their parents were killed. How to go to a place that is controlled by these drug people. How to encrypt the information, how you have to call to your newsroom in a place that is really unsafe. And then another kind of these trainings that how you be emotional safe, because this is really, really hard. You are always like covering and talking with victims of violence and covering massacres and orphans and widows and displaced and disappearance of people. So we did that. And later, many journalists came from other places, from Mexico, and I start asking for help. And they were like, okay, we are in the middle of this battle. We have the government that is pushing and pushing us to publish this. The army is like ordering us to publish this, and the drug traffickers are in the same day calling to and giving these orders, and we don't know what to do. So we start like thinking, and when we see that the killings continue, and there were most repeatedly, more frequently, so we start in, like trying to protest, to do things to visibilize this, to use the social networks to protest on this, and I think we have been done many, many things that the people understand what is happening in Mexico. The same journalists, we take care of ourselves and telling the society that it's important that the journalists don't be killed. But yes, we are like women in this, and I think in human rights defenders too, and the mother of the disappearance, and there is a big thing, like, I don't know, that the women, we are taking this important role now in Mexico. And we are surprised. For example, I have never talked in public, and I never like it. But yeah, you have to do it. It's like part of this. And
I know we've focused and started off the discussion with obviously looking at the very serious issue of murders of journalists, but I wanted to ask all the panelists just to maybe talk through some of the other dynamics and changes they've noticed in the scene with regard to other restrictions or pressures on freedom of expression in Mexico. I think the murders are the thing that's gotten the most attention, especially here in the U.S., but there are many other dynamics and things at play right now, and the situation has actually been changing over the last few years. So I wanted to ask any of the panelists who would like to jump in about, where they see the other pressures, dynamics, restrictions on the press, what types of things are difficult to report, what kind of pushback are journalists receiving if they try to cover these hot topics. And I know some people have on the panel have a personal experience with what's happened, or just sort of a broader perspective, but that'd be great, just to sort of fill out our understanding of the problem.
Well, I think that we have, as Marcela said it, we're not only training ourselves and training others into doing a different kind of journalism than the traditional journalism. And when I say traditional, I'm talking about the kind of journalism that was done in Mexico that had a lot to do with whomever pays is the one that, is in the front cover, which means the governors or the president or the state official that is paying for the publicity of the media, which is something that happens all around the world, but in Mexico and in other countries in which democracy is weak, then it's more visible. But we're jumping those ropes. I mean, we're really changing things, and I'm really excited about that. I have to say this. And on one hand, we're doing this really good journalism in which we are just breaking the rules that most of our editors told us we could never break. I remember like 15 years ago, one of my editors said, Lydia, you're crazy. The way you write, nobody wants to read it, It's like you mixed all these genres. You mixed chronic with your very lyric, and then you do like hard facts. That is not journalism. And then all of a sudden, it is journalism. It's not only journalism. It is the new journalism that we are all doing, because we are crossing the frontiers of the way we used to do it, and we're doing it in a more humane way, which means it's more sensitive. We're daring to be sensitive regarding the interviews of the victims. We are daring to be sensitive while interviewing someone, which was something was absolutely forbidden. Recently, I was interviewing some of the mothers of the young men assassinated or disappeared in Ayotzinapa. And I was talking to them about their childhood. And when we finished, I asked one of them, who amongst all the journalists that have interviewed you, who is the one that has made the best interview for you? And one of them said it was a little girl, they said. She's called Marcela Turati. And she said she sat next to me, and after I talked, she cried. And then she kept in silence for a while. She respected my pain. And then she asked the questions. And the questions were all right. And it was, I mean, she has been interviewed by, 100 journalists from all over the world, and the best one that did the right thing was Marcela. So I think that we're not only doing that kind of journalism, but we are learning to do it the right way in such a situation like the situation we're in. And we are also learning from the good practices from Colombia, of course, but also from the bad practices of Colombia, which is really important. And it's only really the female journalists, the ones that are questioning the bad practices of Colombia and the fake peace negotiations, for example, that are going on in Colombia right now with the FARC and everything. It's only women, the ones that are questioning that. This political charade that they are playing on with the FARC and everything, while we do know for a fact that the FARC still training the narcos from Mexico that go all the way to Colombia to get this specialized training. So we are the ones asking not only the hard questions, as they told us when we were young, but we're asking the best questions in order to be a part of a huge group of educators. We are not an army, we are educators. I think that is the big difference between most of female journalists now in Mexico, is that we are changing not only the discourse, but also the place from where we investigate and we understand and we see people and we feel what is going on. And what it has is a huge cost on our life. Most of us have spent years and years in therapy, of course, otherwise we would be just crazy, haha, and maybe become like the president of Mexico in order to rule and become a tyrant. But if we are here, we're not willing to take that kind of power. We're developing other ways of exercising power, and that is very interesting. We have been tortured, incarcerated, and persecuted, and we receive death threats every, I don't know, I receive death threats every like 1 or 2 months, and Marcela probably pretty much the same. We are getting used to that, we're taking it seriously, we are really denouncing the death threats, but we're not stopping at them. And I think that's really important because we're not like sitting there in the victimhood, as we said before, that is something that has happened in other countries. And in Mexico, it's not happening, so we are not professional victims. And that is really important because that is what the work creates, professional victims or partners in crime. You know, so that is what the press usually does in this kind of war crisis or violent crisis, is that you either stay with the powerful or go with the victims and stay there. And we are in the middle, and it's hard, and it's painful, and we cry a lot, and we have good and bad times, but we are here.
Yeah, well, just some questioning on the role, not of journalism, but of literature, because I think that we, the writers, are not doing the same good work that the journalists are doing. And one of the reasons is that if you see what it's called now in Mexico, narco-narrativa, mm-hmm. and all those novels are market-based, all those narco-narrativas are putting the narcos as heroes, and they are not focused on the victims or the survivors, as Lydia says. Even one of the writers that I like the most is a woman writer from Guerrero, Iris Garcia Cuevas. She wrote a splendid book of short stories, Ojos que no ven, and then she wrote a novel, 36 toneladas, that it's absolutely, again, one of the main, in the mainstream of narco-narratives, that it's focusing on the criminal side of the story, and none on the other side of the story. Because if you think about the statistics, Mexico has more than 112 million people living in the country, and 29 or whatever. We will never know how many are living here. But and then it's just 10% of that population that has kidnapped the country. It's just 10%. That those 10% can be divided between drug lords, the politicians in the elite, the sicarios, and the few peasants. They're not really much, and they are all of them are harvesting drugs because they are threatened. If they don't do it, they will be killed. So, but if you go on that universe, it's just the 10% of the country, and they have kidnapped the 90% of the country that are not, that as we have been saying all morning, not only in this panel, in other panels, good people that are doing good things for Mexico, that are doing the right things. And I think that literature has a, in this moment, has a homework that it's not doing. And that we did it as writers after 1968, and we are not doing it now because market-based literature is pervading almost even important and interesting writers. that they are writing for the market, and they're writing the narratives that the state has been reproducing. They are not doing counter narratives as the journalists, especially women journalists, are doing in Mexico. So I think that's part of the story. And the other story is that these journalists that we have today here think of the social as an enigma, as something that has to be discovered. And they work hard to discover who is behind that social entanglement. And Mexican writers, for the last 20 years at least, are very enamored about their own stories. And they don't go on the social enigmas that pervade our country. So as a reader, not as a writer, but as a reader, I prefer to read what the journalists are doing, because it's not only more truth, obviously that's the main purpose of journalism, and apparently fiction is not truth, but I'm not talking about truth or fiction, I'm talking about this important denunciation of all the entanglements in social life in Mexico. So apparently, if you read 10 or, and I will stop there, 10 or 20 of the new narco novels, the criminals are just the drug dealers, and not the politicians, are not the elite entrepreneurs, not only the politicians, are just the drug dealers. They are the criminals. And what those narratives don't really put on the table is the problem of our society as an enigma that has to be somehow resolved. So I much prefer to read them than to read my peers. And it's a shame, because literature has other important agendas to cover that obviously investigative journalism has not, because of the same purpose of the and the rhetoric of both languages. So I'm really worried about how Mexican writers have been developing the same narratives that the state wants everyone in Mexico to really dwell into.
That's great, Pedro, thank you. Just to follow on, I mean, there are these, you know, very severe restrictions on the media, both because of the murders and the self-censorship, also because of the structure of media ownership, the concentration, and the way in which sort of media owners and politicians are helping to sort of push and control the narrative. Marcela, I wanted to ask you a little bit to talk about some of the pushback. What are, you know, some of the young journalists, some of the freelance journalists trying to do to cover these types of investigative stories, which the mainstream media just are not covering anymore? What are the dynamics you see in terms of, you know, how people are trying to get the stories out under very difficult conditions in Mexico, and how they're trying to do it, where they're trying to do it, what kind of pressures they face when they're doing that?
Yes, I think the most important investigations, maybe you can't see in the press. I don't know. We are, many of us, not just my group, many other journalists, we are trying to create like alternative websites. And many journalists who felt that in the newsroom they are not allowed to investigate things that they're, the majority, I think, in Mexico, the majority of the journalists think that in the media they can't. So we are like using our free time and trying to build another alternative projects. For example, one of the first one that it was a website that convoked Alma Guillermo Prieto, the writer and journalist. And it was that 72 writers and journalists reconstruct the massacre of the 72 migrants. So each one of us, we adopt one migrant and investigate the story. So we did like this first exercise. But then we start like doing another kind of things. For example, I run a website that continue investigating these massacres of migrants. And we are programmers, designers, photographers, to, in our free time, we are like trying to investigate and to continue show the people how the government is involved in these crimes, in these massacres. But sometimes we work like 2 years or more, like trying to share information and do these kind of things. There are another networks that are like documenting this mining, these mega projects, mining, and how they are doing bad in the communities, and and how the people is killed by these projects. So it's always like, you know, we finance this, it's our free time, and we are like always trying to pick some kind of fund just to pay the programmer and the designer, because if don't, they don't want, you have to pay them, and build these kind of things. We said that we want to be like a truth commission on real time, that if somebody in one day in Mexico, if the justice will work one day, they will have this information that we pick all these years, and we want to make this clear, and we want that the justice one day, they can have this information and they can have all our articles and how we systemize this, and see if we can contribute to the truth or the justice, we don't know, but the truth we want. We are clear of this. So that's our, for example, in this moment, we want to create a big, big map of mass graves in the whole country. And we are like calling many journalists from the whole country, if you know where is a mass grave, and if you follow one of them, we can map this. And because the NGOs, the human rights defenders, haven't done this, and the government don't have a registration, but the journalists, we have it, because we daily cover these kind of things, so we have to give a different sense of our articles, our information, to create another kind of things and collaborative, and do, I don't know, and we feel that is our role in this moment.
Can I add just something? Because probably some of you, if you don't know Mexico, you will think that that's the press, but it's not the press. Press in Mexico is sold to the government, so these type of experiences are really, really rare. And it's incredible, because if you hear what Lydia and what Marcela are saying, is they are doing the investigative pieces that the justice had to do. They are putting their efforts where there were, I mean, in a normal country, those efforts could be done by the justice or the judicial system. But it's not the press, because if you hear this, and that's the only thing that I wanted to add, you will probably think, okay, Mexico is really full of crazy journalists that are doing the great job. No, we have a very, very, we have a handful of great examples, and then the press sold to the government and to the money.
Okay, I was trying not to end on a negative note. So, but yes, no, it's true. I mean, I would agree that the mainstream press, especially television, I think, is largely, and radio, the broadcast media is largely in the hands of the government, and does not really engage in this type of journalism. And that's why we're so fortunate to have these journalists here and to hear about some of these positive stories and the pushback. So, you know, in a nutshell, I mean, there are many very negative aspects of the media environment in Mexico, but you know, we don't want it to appear that it's all negative. There is a lot of positive work going on the ground, and a lot of pushback by local journalists. There's a glass half full and a glass half empty, definitely. And we're lucky to hear some of the positive stories tonight also. I'd like to open it up now for questions from the audience so we can get a bit of participation. So we'll get a few questions, answers, and then we'll have a little time to sum up right at the end for our participants. So, yeah.
Articles you write, has there been, I don't think this is on.
It's all right, that's
the English. Has there been, what is the response of the public, the general public, to the what they're reading either in print or what they're reading, as Marcela said, on the on the internet? How is the public receiving this?
Well, in my experience, it's an incredible reaction. When I started writing about child pornography, for example, 10 years ago, when people thought it was crazy, then all of a sudden we saw hundreds and hundreds of people going into the streets to demand the protection of the children. And thanks to that uproar that created the publishing of one of my books, of a very, very in-depth investigation on child pornography linked to senators and governors, then hundreds of people marched in Mexico and provoked two laws were created, the law against child pornography and the law against human trafficking. And that is the reason why the guy wrote about in my book ended up with the first sentence ever in Latin America of 113 years for child pornography and human trafficking. And that, I didn't do it. Of course, the children that denounced were the heroes there and the heroines. But basically what happened was society was in an uproar with that. That is exactly the same thing that has happened with the Ayotzinapa cases. And with most of the cases that we write about, for example, the rape of women or domestic violence or gender violence in general, last Sunday we had the biggest march, national march ever in Mexican history, of women all over the country, and men. A lot of men, of course, went with us, and the march around Mexico to demand that gender violence stop, not only in real life here, but also in the cyberspace, which is a terrible problem all over the world. So, in my experience and the experience of many of the women that I work with in the national network of journalists is that people react really well. They write back at our pieces in the newspapers, or they send us letters, emails, and everything, and people are really engaging in the pieces and responding to them. And it has to do with the perspective from which we write or talk or speak or investigate.
Sometimes I think that nobody read us. Sometimes I think that, not just me, like many of us, we think like, okay, we spent 2 years of our lives and no other media or not, there is not article in the newspaper and nobody say nothing about this big effort. But I think we want to inspire another journalist to do the same, and that we are, and sometimes many journalists like write and say like, oh, we in the North, we are trying to do like this experience. For example, we did a book and multimedia project that it was about the victims of the violence who resist and organize themselves to save them and to save others. It was in 2012, because we felt that we just, in the past, the past government, we just talk and write about the victims and the tragedy. And at the end of the administration, or at the end of the presidency, we say like, okay, maybe we just talk about this suffering and we don't talk about how they resist. And it's important, this part. So we 10 journalists and 10 photographers, we were together and did this book. And in some places, the journalists were like, oh, it's important to do that. So we will replicate this and we will do the same. So the message is, no matter what kind of pressure you have, if you can do it. No, you as journalists, you can do it something. And sometimes we think that nobody read us, but for the victims, it's important. And the victims always, the mother of a disappearing child, they are always like close, and they say like, I want to thank you because you talk or you write this notice about this article about my son. And if one day I recover him, I will show your article because you are the witness of that I am looking for him, no? So, and it's important, like, do this job. I think we won't notice what impact it will have, but it's like question of faith to think that one day this information will, I don't know, will save a life, or somebody will have a visa if it needed because you write this, and you maybe you never notice what will happen, but you have to do this as like thinking that it's important doing, and it's our job. Our job is document everything daily. Maybe we don't know what will happen with this information, but in some years, in 10 years, in 20 years, I don't know when, this will make sense and this will be part of a truth commission.
No, thank you. Magali, you wanted to jump in a little bit.
Sí, a mí me gustaría decir que justo lo que están escribiendo todos estos periodistas de la nueva generación, entre otras cosas, es la crónica del futuro, es la crónica que dentro de 20, 30 años van a leer como crónica histórica de lo que sucedió en nuestro país. Es una labor fundamental. También es muy importante el tema de la vida cotidiana. No, el de las víctimas es importantísimo, y como tema complementario, una de las preguntas es, ¿cómo cambió tu vida cuando comenzó la violencia? Porque a todos nos cambió la vida. Vivamos donde vivamos, aunque no tengamos un pariente asesinado, aunque no tengamos un familiar torturado, a todos nos cambió la vida. Estamos viviendo un país en donde el imaginario colectivo se ha llenado de desastres, de imágenes terribles. Entonces, es muy importante conservar esa memoria. Otra cosa que quería comentar muy brevemente es que una de las cosas muy importantes de este tipo de diálogos, de venir a Nueva York y poder dialogar con un público al que normalmente no tenemos acceso en la Ciudad de México o en el país en general, es el hecho de que podemos decirles, oye, Estados Unidos nos vende las drogas que usan nuestros narcotraficantes. Nuestros narcotraficantes son los mejor equipados en cuestión de armas. Estados Unidos es el mayor consumidor de drogas. No lo olviden, tenemos que arreglar juntos el problema. Es como un mal matrimonio, un matrimonio mal avenido, en donde hay mucha violencia, mucho desastre, pero en este tipo de diálogos creo que tenemos que aclarar eso. Y por último, muy brevemente, quería decir que no estoy totalmente de acuerdo con Pedro Palou, a quien respeto mucho, porque en el sentido de que yo no estoy de acuerdo que los literatos tengan necesariamente que hacer una tarea política. Mucha de esa literatura se convierte en literatura panfletaria, y no hay nada más abominable que la literatura panfletaria. Yo creo que el literato debe hacer su tarea, el escritor, sin pensar en una temática, porque si no, su literatura puede decaer terriblemente. Cuando Dostoyevsky escribió Los demonios, él se basó en un activista asesinado de su época que pertenecía a un partido rebelde. Él se basó en eso, pero si él hubiera dejado eso en periodismo, no tendríamos esa obra maestra que se llama Los demonios. Y si él hubiera pensado en que quiero decir y denunciar, No tenemos esa literatura. Entonces, al hablar de literatura, no puedo estar de acuerdo con que un periodista, un escritor tenga que ponerse una agenda propia. Sí estoy en desacuerdo con los periodistas, con los escritores que quieren estar de acuerdo con el mercado, pero el que escribe honestamente, como David Toscana, como Valeria Luiselli, como Brenda Lozano, como Guillermo Fadanelli, hay muchísimos grandes escritores de la generación nacida que tiene ahorita 40, 50 años o alcanza quizá los 60, que son extraordinarios, que no están escribiendo narconovela, por decirlo despectivamente. Y bueno, eso era lo que quería decir.
I was just talking about the writers that write narconovela. I was
yes,
not
I
was
understand.
Not describing the entire generation or that every other
I
writer in Mexico
that.
Need to have that political agenda. Because the other thing with literature is that the form itself is always struggling with social issues. You don't need to create a special book with a special thematic. I was just talking about the persons that are writing narconovelas because that's what the market is demanding. And then those writers are the ones that are recreating the same narrative from the state and creating the same type of heroes and anti-heroes that we see even in television.
Lomnitz. It's that's really helpful. Other questions from the audience? I think there was one over here. Yep.
Clarify, is that it? A little bit. The publications are owned by the wealthy and the corrupt, you are saying, and you're doing work on websites and so on. I thought I understood, but you mentioned the newsroom and you mentioned your editors. So are some of the establishment publications supporting you?
No. Of course, not all media is wicked in general, just in particular. Of course, most of us, for example, Marcela publishes in Proceso, no? But sometimes some of his articles are cited in Milenio, which is very pro-government. So it's not as easy as black and white. It's quite complex. I decided to go freelance 15 years ago, not only because I was pressured to do so by the owners of the newspapers that didn't like the kind of investigations I was going into, because at the same time that they really liked what I was doing or respected, they knew that the money for the publicity for the newspaper was coming from the governor. So if I was investigating the governor, for example, of Quintana Roo, that is now in jail for drug links to the drug dealers, to the drug cartels, They were in a conundrum there because, you know, I was writing about the guy who is giving money to the newspaper. So this is something we're dealing with all the time with the media. And sometimes we have some media that hire us for to publish certain investigations, and sometimes they don't. Now, most of us are writing books, too. And obviously the big publishers like Planeta or Random House, Penguin Random House in Mexico, are publishing all of our work that nobody else would. And then on the other hand, it's like the new media, the new multimedia outlets. Some of them are doing a good job, and some of them are also playing the game. So it's just you go day by day, you know, and you try to sort of infiltrate in the media as much as you can.
Okay, other questions from the audience? Yeah?
Hi, my name is Sergio, I'm from Guatemala. I'm here because my country has very similar problems, and also some years ago I read the book of Bolaño, 2666. Which actually pointed me to Sergio González Rodríguez, mm-hmm. and then to Lidia Cacho, and then, you know, so I'm a musician. I have been reacting with my music to some of these issues, in the context of Guatemala. But so I wanted to ask Pedro, yeah, what he thought of if Bolaño, if he like if you think of him as someone that also is part of this market.
No, not at all. Bolaño was always a marginal writer, so he survived in Barcelona by having small municipal prizes, and then all of a sudden, after Los Detectives Salvajes, he became a success. But this was a posthumous novel, and as you know, it was intended to be published in five different books. So the widow and the publisher and Jorge Herralde decided that it was more convenient for the market to publish it as a whole novel. But it was not intended that way by Bolaño. And after his death, especially because in the United States, he has been run by a very, very important agent, Andrew Wiley, that probably you know as the Chuckle of New York. So he has went on to a new success. But the consequences are really good for Latin American literature because, as you know, in the United States, only 3% of the books that are published each year, 3% are translations. Translations of every other language, 3%. Of 60, last year they were published 67,000 books in the United States. And of those 67,000 books, only 3% were translations. And Bolaño did a very good job, even posthumously, bringing new writers to be translated into English, because that was something that was stopped after the boom. So Bolaño is, in every other sense, a very good thing for Latin American literature. And I always say that he's the only Chilean writer that knew Mexico better than the Mexicans. He lived there for a long time before going to Barcelona. And Estrella Distante, for me, is his masterwork, and it's on 68 and the UNAM, so, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions from the audience? No? Yeah, make one in the back, and then we'll probably have to wrap up.
Hi, you talked a little bit about how the rise of digital media and publications online have opened up a lot of opportunities for the press. I was curious about some of the challenges that have also come along with those new technologies, whether that be cyber attacks, surveillance, or even just how to make digital media profitable.
Great question. Does anyone?
Marcela.
Marcela,
do you want to jump in?
About cyber attacks.
Well, a while ago, pretty much at the same time we opened two outlets, media outlets, and one of them was Sin Embargo. I was part of the founding and the creation of Sin Embargo, and it's a media outlet, an independent media outlet, and what we did since the beginning was creating such a hard protected system that we had, like, our servers were protected, in three different countries, and one in Russia, and this and that. And then 6 months later, when we had one of our first breakthroughs in the news, we had the worst attack ever. And they took us down. They were trying not only to attack the servers, but also try to destroy all the information. I mean, it was like a mean thing. And we fortunately had a good team to discover who it was, and it came from the central government, from the equivalent to the CIA in Mexico. And we're not the only ones, but we're probably one of the few that knew how to hack onto the hackers to understand who was doing the dirty job. This is something that is happening all over the world. It's happening in Russia, it's happening in Kyrgyzstan, in Mexico, in Guatemala, in Colombia, everywhere, even in the US, of course. And then for surveillance, obviously, the Mexican government is following the path of the American government. It's like they're surveilling everything. Even when you pee, they're surveilling you. Of course, if you take your cell phone to the bathroom, they will know that you're peeing. or otherwise. Yes, most of us are using technology, trying to protect ourselves, but then we are going through the same crisis that everyone else is around the world, which is if you encrypt, then you know that you might be protected from, for example, the drug cartels that we are investigating right now. But if you encrypt, then you naturally are investigated not only by the Mexican military and the Mexican Secret Service, but also by the American Secret Service in Mexico that is very well known for doing so. So you have to take decisions on the go if you will encrypt or not. With the cell phones and with the phone calls and, of course, with through email and everything. And all of the outlets are going through the same thing. Of course, there is a big pressure of big companies trying to buy publicity from the outlets in order to control information. That is a new thing that has been happening the last 12 months that was different. Beforehand, nobody had, like, money to, you know, we had to get together and get all this money from friends and stuff to open a media like that. If you had enough hits and enough, you know, enough readers, then you would have someone from Google giving you all this publicity. But nowadays, we see a new trend, which is all these big companies are going like, okay, I'll buy publicity from you, including governments, of course, if you just go easy on this. And some of the outlets that were, at least, from our point of view, progressive, are falling into that because otherwise they wouldn't be able to pay the reporters, which is another huge problem for everyone around the world. It's like I do most of my articles in any outlet that I publish, I give for free, and I live off of my books, for example. But not everyone can do that, and almost no one wanna pay for a good piece of investigation and investigative reporting. So it's a huge crisis, and it's a huge economical crisis, which is also talking of our work, of course, because sometimes you do what Marcela and periodistas de a pie are doing, which is fantastic, is setting a trend, which is if 10 reporters from different parts of the country are bringing bits and pieces from an investigation from their places and not expending a lot of money, then you can have a really good investigation. And that is the new trend, and we're following on that. Well, I would obviously recommend Sin Embargo, although I'm not part of it anymore. No, I would recommend Sin Embargo, Animal Político. Of course, Proceso has its own page.
Vice
News. Yeah, it's very sexist in their office, but it's good news. So anyway, of course,
bueno, es que
that's a whole other panel. But
acaba
anyway,
de nacer un nuevo equipo.
So Marcela, which is the one?
Sí.
No sé qué más.
The project that I talk about is más de 72. M-A-S, bueno, más de 72 punto org. Punto org. Y el libro que les decía de las víctimas que resisten, The Victims That Resist, is Entre las Cenizas, Among the Ashes. It's a book that you can, it's just one part in English, but almost everything is in Spanish. And there is a website, Nuestra Aparente Rendición, that is many people from different places and Mexico and other countries, they contribute to analyze the violence, how to deal with this, what is happening in Mexico. That is really interesting place.
Horizontal.mx.
Horizontal.org. They have analysis.
Oh, CIMAC Noticias. If you want gender specialized news, that is fantastic. It has radio, it has TV, and it has like hard news. It's CIMACNoticias.org, which is really, really good. And it's been done by journalists all over Latin America, including Guatemala, from Colombia, Argentina, and all of Central America and Mexico. CIMAC Noticias. CIAMAC. Noticias, N-O-T-I-C-E, Noticias. Wow, I won't win at spelling bee. dot org.
Okay, so también dot org. En el camino, oh, yeah. On the road, en el camino, that is about migration, the yeah. the issues of the migrants, mm-hmm. and pie de página.
Yeah.
That is about human rights things. Barrio Antiguo is another one of the north of the country.
Okay. Hopefully that's enough of a top 10 list. But if you didn't get the actual URLs, oh, one more. Okay.
In English, not no. One part of a book is in English, but it's just one little part. But you, yes. No. En inglés no hay nada.
No.
No, ¿verdad?
No. En México no.
Aristegui. Ah, bueno, Aristegui Noticias. That's our website.
Well,
yeah. Sí.
No, well, my page is called mediacacho.com, which has Spanish and English and French news. Lydia Cacho with my name is lydiacacho.com. A-C-H-O. Cacho.
C-A-C-H-O. Okay, Brianne, thank you so much for everyone on the panel. We really appreciate all the interventions, insights.